Kia ora koutou, welcome back to Q+A. It's panel time. Here this evening, Penny Hulse, Auckland councillor, and Elliot Ikile, the deputy leader of the new Conservative Party. Tēnā kōrua. Thanks for being with us. Let's start with superannuation this evening. Penny, do we need to raise the age of eligibility?
It's so interesting. It's probably something I didn't think a lot about. Now I've turned 60. You know, it's just around the corner. I am interested in that whole how deserving are we? You know, if we're doing okay financially, would we be better off saying, you know, let's just push it out a little bit and share that money around? I thought the point that was made about, however, making sure that we care for people who are worn out and who simply 65 is too hard to keep on working, I think we can't lose sight of those people.
No, I don't think anyone is suggesting that we don't look after those people, but it's how you look after them and whether or not we should have superannuation there or whether or not those people should be going on to unemployment benefits, for example.
Yeah, the standardised superannuation, regardless of whether you're a multimillionaire or, you know, someone on the bones of their butt, it's incredibly attractive, and at 60 it's very, very attractive. Mm. But in a funding constrained environment, is it necessarily the best thing? I'm not entirely convinced.
What do you think, Elliot?
Well, actually, I take a slightly different position than Penny on that. I think in terms of superannuation, there's a philosophical bent to it, which is, as a country, as a nation, we have a very objective understanding of life being precious. Therefore, I think that it is fine to have this 65 and then everyone gets the superannuation, whether they've got millions of dollars or if they've got no money whatsoever.
OK, so we're not means testing it under that, but, I mean, people are living longer now. You know, 65 is the same age of eligibility that we had in the late 1800s. Mm. So shouldn't we raise it a couple of years?
Well, I actually don't think we need to, and I say that very carefully. I do like the discussion that you had with Diane and Richard. Mm. And it was very interesting, but Richard was saying that there's a bit of an alarmism aspect to it, which I totally agree with. And then Diane is also speaking about that if we looked at spending, we need to be a bit more prioritising of that spending. Now, absolutely right. And I think there are some borderline foolish things that we're spending money on now. For example, carbon credits, free years, tertiary education, things like that, that can be repurposed.
I mean, to be fair, though, under Richard's... So, first of all, Richard's figures are from net figures, and they allow for a few things, right? So they allow for contributions from the super fund, which aren't happening at the moment. He also kept on mentioning a progressive tax system. That means tax increases, certainly for wealthier people in New Zealand. So all of these things come at cost. Some way or another, we have to pay for this.
He did make the point, which I thought was a good one, that it's a bit rich, you know, talking about tax cuts at the same time as raising the age of super. And I, you know, what Diane's been trying to do over the years has been just having a far more well-considered discussion about superannuation, because we very quickly rush straight to, you know, do we put the age of eligibility up and how do we manage that, or do we means test it? But we never go back to first principles, which is, what's super there for? You know, is it as a buffer to give people choices as they age? Is it there to care for people in their old age? Or is it there to simply reward people for contributions, you know, for 65 years of contributing well to a society? And I think that discussion is perhaps the really big one that we need to be having.
I would also add in, actually, that we should also be looking at the Section 70, you know, where we've got, if you work for 10 years here, then suddenly you get the superannuation.
This is what New Zealand First is considering at the moment.
Put it up to 30, 35, and then if that's the case, then you can do it pro rata from that 10 years.
Okay.
So I think that one.
Let's talk about place names. Should we change place names in New Zealand? Colonial place names that are upsetting to some people?
That was a pretty compelling item. I was just saying to one of the people earlier on, I grew up in South Africa, and post-1994, the ANC changed a lot of the names from the bad old apartheid era, you know, D.F. Malan Airport to Oliver Tambo Airport, a whole lot of street names. And a lot of us cheered that on. It seemed like absolutely the right thing to do. But it's balancing out with, you can't, you know, expunge all parts of history. But I would find it pretty galling living in a community where, you know, a street name was named after someone who had murdered my people. So I am a supporter of looking at those name changes.
I would say no, definitely not. Why not? I think we all have a history, even as individuals, we all have bad and good things that we have done in our lives. I think as a nation, there are good and bad things that all of us have done in our lives. And if we're going to start to erase elements of our history, I think that's a dangerous road.
I'm suggesting we erase history, although I appreciate your concern. But you know, what about in these communities where the very nature of the community has been completely and irreparably damaged by someone's actions, and every day you go outside and you see that person's name right in front of you?
Well, I mean, if we're thinking about mindsets, then the mindset can change from generation to generation. If we're talking about temporary psychological dispositions on certain things like a street name or a landmark, sure, that could be seen as a bit of an issue.
Yeah.
But we're talking about history. We're not talking about something. I have an issue with it, and suddenly my child has no issue with it.
But
my grandfather
fleeting.
Has no issue.
Mm. No, I think we get really stuck in it. It's a bit of a New Zealand is a really young nation, and I think we take our history incredibly seriously. You know, this is not to be messed with. I actually think we should engage in that debate and that discussion. You know, you travel around Europe, there are places that have had 10, 15, 20 different place names as history rolls over the top of them. And I think we should be up to having debate and education and understanding about places that are named for oppressors and murderers. You know, I just, that's not holding on to history, that's saying let's have another look at the damn thing.
Elliot, let me ask you about the Alfred Ngaro interview. why do you think Alfred Ngaro was uncomfortable answering a simple question about whether or not he agrees with Israel Folau?
Well, I think there's also the theological aspect. I mean, one of the big things in the Bible, from what I understand, is that you do not do the big judgment at the end of the day. So those who of us, when we all die...
So if we're still on Sunday mornings, we'd be all right. No, but I mean, but it's a straightforward question. Do you agree with Israel Folau or not? It's a yes or no question.
Well, I definitely agree with his ability to say what he wants to say.
No, yeah, okay, I know you agree with that. But why is it? Like the conservative Christian people say that they want a voice and they don't want their voice to be oppressed, but then when you ask a very simple question about whether or not you support a point of view that has been expressed, you can't get a straight answer. I find that...
Well, I mean, the Bible's actually pretty clear. You don't... There are certain judgments that you can make based on behaviours and certain patterns on some aspects, and on other aspects, you've got no right and no ability to judge either. That's sort of basic theology.
So do you think Israel Folau was wrong to make that judgment?
No, I think Israel Folau is doing what he believes to be right, and that should be his right to speak that out. It should be a very basic thing. And my Twitter ban, for example, that I got done for, that is
you banned on Twitter?
I was banned on Twitter.
Oh, dear.
But that was for saying something and then following with to be compassionate and tolerant.
OK, Penny, do you think conservative voices are appropriately represented in New Zealand politics?
I think they are on the rise. I'm fascinated with the, you know, watching Alfred, who's a good man, really struggle with that question. And I think that's what we're going to see in conservative and Christian politics. Some of these people and politicians are actually good, kind people, but that doesn't always sit comfortably with sort of hardline Christian ethics. So, you know, the need to comment on Israel Folau, for instance. What Israel Folau said publicly, I think, was unforgivable. You know, it was damning a whole lot of people who were simply living their lives as queer and gay people. Mm. But a kind person like Alfred is obviously struggling putting those two ideas together, and I think that is going to be the challenge for the rise of the Christian fundamental groups.
Elliot, given Alfred was considering, for a brief window there, starting a new party informed by conservative Christian values, and given your party is informed, at the very least, by conservative values, I believe, how optimistic are you ahead of next year's election?
Very optimistic.
Give me a number. What are you aiming for?
I would like 20 in 2020. I want 20%.
20% of the vote?
I want 20% of the general election.
Is that a realistic expectation?
I think so. Yep, absolutely.
You think 20%
looking
of
over the
New
last,
Zealanders?
Looking after the last 3-4 months, we are running at the second or third most engaged New Zealand political party on our Facebook page. That's heaps of people there. And they are annoyed and they're angry and a little bit anxious about some of the aspects of free speech being removed currently.
OK. Well, as I always say on this programme, don't forget social media isn't the real world. Tēnā kōrua. Thanks for your time, guys.
Mārie.
Really appreciate it.
Kia ora.